The Lord is gracious to us. I hope I'm audible.
You are Muruti, and your video is very clear. You
All
look very
right.
good. You look very good.
Thank you. Thank you so
Yes.
much. It is a joy and a blessing to be here. And this week, I would like us to look on the topic that I have entitled The Blessing of the Prophetic Voice. I want to say good morning, blessed of my Father. It's a joy and a blessing to be here again. This is our family, this is our home, and it's again a blessing to lean on the everlasting arms this morning. I would like to give a title this morning. As you know, all of you now are aware that my title mainly all the time is Too Blessed to Be Stressed. And today we'll just have a colorant again, and I would entitle it Too Filled to Be Fooled. Too filled to be fooled. You know, many a times, because of emptiness, they say an empty vessel makes more noise, and a filled vessel won't really make much noise. You are not troubled when you are filled, but you are troubled when you are empty. The Bible text that I would like to refer to this morning is found in the book of Psalms. I just want to say to you, I learned a lot when we were doing the lesson study on Psalms, and I'm just going to share with you my takeaway from the book of Psalms this morning. And I'll start with Psalm 59. The psalmist here, you know, says something here that really struck me. And as we go through the Psalms, you will discover something that is really amazing to me. And it really shows me that the prophetic voice is really a blessing to us, that God can never ever leave us. He will forever love us. Now it says here in verse 1, Psalm 59, deliver me from my enemies, O Lord. Defend me from those who rise up against me. Deliver me from the workers of iniquity and save me from the bloodthirsty men. For look, they lie in wait for my life. The mighty gather against me, not for my transgression nor for my sin, O Lord. They run, prepare themselves through no fault of mine. Awake to help me, and behold, O Lord, my help. And verse 5 says, you therefore, O Lord God of hosts, the God, awake, punish all the nations. Do not be merciful to any wicked transgressors. Oh, what a prayer. I would like to look at this and say, I'll give it three ways that I would like you to remember, or three phrases: a good prayer, a great prayer, and a significant prayer. Now, here we see a good prayer that David is praying, and he's praying, his concern really is the enemies. He wants God to deliver him from his enemies. And I would like to call this a good prayer, because he really wants to be delivered. But as he goes on, you realize that his concern, really, his focus is on the enemies. He wants these enemies gone. He wants these enemies destroyed completely so that he can live a good life, a joyous life. I'm thankful to God, because David is praying. It's a prayer. Thank God at least he's praying to God, even though his focus is not on God, it's on the enemies. So I would like to term this a good prayer. And I'd like to say this is a prayer of somebody who is fooled by the devil, that he can only progress and he can only make strides in life only when the enemies are gone and they are not there and he's the only one. And this is the attitude that the devil wants us to come with to the Lord God of heaven, as if it's only when the problems are gone that we live a wonderful life. It's only when the enemies and there's nothing against me that then I live a good life. That's why he ends in verse 5 by saying, never, O Lord, be merciful on my enemies. But I think you know what the Bible says. He causes his son to rise on those who believe in him and those who don't believe in him. His son rises upon those who hate him and those who love him. So that's the God that we worship. And here his prayer is a good prayer. At least he is praying. Let's give him a credit for praying to the Lord God of heaven. But thank God, that he doesn't just stay there. He grows in his relationship and his walk with God. He doesn't remain in one place where he thinks everyone else must be dead in order for me to enjoy this life. Actually, a story is told of a man who was approached by a rich man, and he said, "Whatever I'm going to give you, I'll give each other person that is in the community where you stay a double portion of whatever I'm going to give you. I'll give you one and I'll give them a double portion." And his response was, "Oh, wonderful. Now you want to bless me? Oh, yes, I want to bless you. Okay, can you make me blind one eye?" What does that mean? This means that if he is made blind one eye, then the rest of the people will be blind on both eyes. So he'll be the only one to see what is there. That's how sometimes we come to God as children of God. But I want to say to you, I'm thankful to God that David does not continue groaning in his prayer, but he grows in his prayer. And we see this now in Psalm chapter 34. Psalm 34 here shows that now he moves from a good prayer into a what? Into a great prayer. In Psalm 34, this is what he says now. In verse 1, he says, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be on my mouth." Now, the question is, are the enemies gone that now he is praising God? Are they all dead that now he is praising the Lord God of heaven? And then I want to say to you, the answer is no. The enemies are there still, but he blesses the Lord continually at all times. This is growth. You can't be in the 5 a.m. prayer and continue to pray the prayer of groaning, continue to pray the prayer of anger, the prayer of stress. You cannot stress and pray at the same time. You have to move from good to great as a child of God, because you are no longer focusing on the enemy. Sometimes we have the prayer, it is good, but we need to move from the focus from the enemy and move the focus to the God who is greater than the enemy and greater than all the challenges that we may have in our lives. And he says, "I'll praise the Lord at all times." Why are you praising God? He answers that question in verse 4. We don't have time to cover everything. But in verse 4, he says, "I sought the Lord and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears." Now, here he's not talking about delivering him from all his enemies. Remember his prayer in chapter 59, he was saying, "Deliver me from my enemies." But now here he says, "I was wrong when I think all I needed was just to be delivered from the enemies and to destroy all the enemies." He says, the challenge is not the enemies out there. The challenge is inside. I'm the one who was too afraid of the enemies. I thought they were going to destroy me. It's because I myself had a problem. I was not growing. Now, Lord, you have brought me to another level. And now I know that it's my fears that actually concoct and create things that do not even exist. You know, when you are afraid and you are walking in the bush, when you bend this way, even the trees seem to bend your way. When the stump is just standing there of a tree and you bend this way, it appears it's looking at you and checking you because of stress and because of worry that you have. That's what emptiness can do in life. But when he comes here to God and he's delivered from his fears, it's amazing what he says. His focus has moved from outside to inside. And from inside, now he connects with the God of heaven. That's why in verse 7 of chapter 34, he could say, "The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear his name and delivers them." What does he mean? He means here that the enemies may continue to exist. We may coexist, but the fact remains, when I trust in the Lord, I have a permanent and pensionable camp, if you please, around me. The enemies may come, but they will not destroy me. They may attack in one way, but they will disappear in a thousand ways, because now I'm moving from focusing on them and I focus on God. One of the reasons why we don't sleep at night is because we focus more on the problem than on the promise of God. That's why in verse 8 he says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him." The psalmist is literally saying, I trusted so much in myself. And I thought I am the one who probably could fight them and win. And I focused on them and looked at their power and elevated their power. But now in their presence, I realize that my God is greater than my enemies. Let me move fast so that I don't take too much of your time. But I wish you can take time and read these chapters and read chapter 34. It's an amazing chapter. In verse 22, he says, "The Lord redeems the soul of his servants, and none of those who trust in him shall be condemned." It doesn't matter what has happened or what you have done. When you trust the Lord, he will pick you up from where you are, from the miry clay, and he plants your feet on the solid rock, Christ Jesus. We move from the good prayer, we came to the great prayer, and now we are moving to the prayer of significance. While the problems are there, that's why I always say, you know, peace does not mean the absence of trouble, but peace means the presence of Jesus in the, brothers and sisters, peace means the presence of Jesus in the midst of trouble, because he's able to navigate. Now let's come to our favorite chapter in the Bible. I think it's a well-known psalm in the Word of God, Psalm 23. The psalmist says something here. In Psalm 23. Now he's still praying. Now he's praying. Now moving to another level of prayer. We must grow in prayer. We must grow in grace. We must grow in the knowledge of God. And the psalmist portrays that for us. A prayer of significance. Verse 1, he says, "The Lord is my shepherd." Now he realizes that the enemies may lurk around. The problems may lurk around. But the promise is greater than the problem. This one, he says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters." Does God do this after he has, removed every problem, every challenge that he had? Is it the time after he has killed all the enemies? And I want to say to you, the answer is no. Verse 3, he says, "He restores my soul. Oh, my soul that was troubled by what happened at work. What happened in my house? What happened in my life? I've lost my job. This has happened to me. Can God still restore my soul?" He's not restoring the things that I need yet. He's not answered the prayer that I've been praying yet. I want you to see something here. The psalmist does not say, "He has given me a double portion of the things that I need." He says, "He restores my soul." First and foremost, God is not interested in giving us things. God is interested in giving us himself by indwelling us and restoring our souls in the midst of challenges. Because then he knows we are equipped enough to move through all the challenges of life. And then he goes on to say, "He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." Praise the Lord. Now, this is the anchor text now. Verse 4. He says, "Yeah. Though I go through the..." No, actually, the anchor text is verse 5. Verse 4, he says, "Though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." Now, I want you to note something here. The psalmist does not say, "Even though I go into the valley of the shadow of death." He says, "Even though I go through..." So, as a child of God, the valleys of death, the challenges of life will be there. But you are not there to stay. You are there to go through, because he has restored your soul. He has taken residence in your life. And therefore, whatever situation, you are not there to stay. You are too blessed to stay there. You are too blessed, my brother, to be stressed by that situation, because you are going through. It's a refinery. Thank God he's polishing you to go through that place. Verse 5, this is the anchor text now. It says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." Now, I want you to note this. You know, in the first, the good prayer, he was saying, "Lord, destroy the enemies." No, but we have mission Monday tomorrow. We have to preach to them. So if you preach, if you destroy them, the question is, who am I going to preach to? They must leave so that they may see who you are in my life. Now, verse 5, he says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." He does not prepare in their absence. This now shows you and me that we should understand and focus on the power of God. that God is able to give enemies life to live, so that as they live, they may be able to see how my God prepares. So I'm no longer focusing on the enemies. I'm focusing on my God. And he comes down and he prepares a table before me. He anoints my head with oil and my cup runneth over. You know, the first phrase that says he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies actually says to you and to me, we need to go back to our bedrooms, to our fridges. We need to go back to our offices where we are troubled by enemies and just write a placard there and put it on the wall and say, Lord, give my enemies long life so that they may see my success and your greatness in my life. This is what the Bible is saying to me. Not to kill the enemies, not that they may lose their jobs. Let them work and get the money. But beyond getting the money, beyond doing what they are doing, let them see that God is great in my life. This is the most important thing to me. But then he says also something here in verse 5. The second one he says, you anoint my head with oil, my cup runneth over. This is where I picked our title for this morning, to fill to be full. Now, when God fills your heart, when God fills your mind with his promises, when God fills your life with himself, your cup runs over. You have no place in your heart even to hate an enemy or to entertain an enemy. Your cup is so full that you are looking for people you can share with all the time. That's why Jeremiah says, when I don't share the gospel, you know, my body itself is complaining. It's like fire in my bones. God fills our cups that my enemy has no power to control me at all. Let me say this. You know, a person who angers you and stresses you is the very person who controls you. So when God fills your life with the Holy Spirit, it doesn't matter who does what to you. What matters to you is that you are filled by the Spirit. You can be angry at me. You can do all sorts of things against me, but I'll still smile at you because my heart is full. My cup is full and it's running over. It is not empty. It is running over. I cannot be fooled by the devil. That's why when Christ speaks to the people who are filled by God, this is what he says in Matthew chapter 5 on the Sermon on the Mount, talking to those who are filled by God. This is not just for everyone, but to those who are filled by God. He says to them here in verse 43, he says to them, to us, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But verse 44, he says, but I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you. How can I pray for a person who abuses me? How can I bless them honestly? I want to say to you, my brothers and sisters, the word of God is so powerful. This prophetic word is a ministry that ministers to my heart and to your heart, to my life and to your life. And when God has filled our cups, it doesn't matter what the enemy does. They may continue to do, but no weapon formed against me shall prevail. I can kneel down and pray for the enemies because I move from a good prayer to a great prayer and then to a prayer of significance because I sit at the table with the Lord God of heaven. Oh, brothers and sisters, this morning, allow the feeling of the Lord to be in your heart, in your mind, in your life, and let God himself be God in your life such that you can even pray for your enemy. This is where you need to move a level higher. That's a prayer of significance. We don't just pray prayers where we are praying for things that we need. It's high time that we pray even for people who are against us so that they may see our God is greater than they are. We cannot continue to groan all the time. It's time for us to rejoice in the Lord because our souls are restored by the God of heaven. And the Bible's promises are very clear. Pray for that boss this morning. I challenge you. Pray for that child this morning. Who is up? Pray for that husband this morning. Pray for those people that are ganging up against you. Let the gang care come, but they will meet one angel of God who can go to Sennacherib's camp and kill 185,000. We don't live like street kids. We are children of the kingdom, and our God is a God who cares. He is great and mighty. Let me just close by reading one of my favorite chapters here. One of my favorite promise here, Jeremiah 20 verse 11. I just close with this and then we pray, we call it a day. But I want you to lift up and to come up to a prayer of significance. It says here, verse 11, but the Lord is with me as a mighty, awesome one. Therefore, my persecutors will stumble and they will not prevail. They will be greatly ashamed, for they will not prosper. Their everlasting confusion will never be forgotten. This is one of the greatest promises. Just one thing you need to know is that you are never alone. He walks with you. For the blessed promise of God says, the Lord God is with me and he will never ever leave me alone. Never be too fooled to be filled. Be filled this morning with the presence of God. Let us pray together. Father, we thank you this morning that you are a great God who teaches us how to pray and who guides us in our lives. May you fill each one of us this morning with the power of the Holy Spirit, that our cups may overflow even to the people that we never thought we can open our mouths to bless them. Thank you for the abundance of your blessings that we can share with others. In Jesus' name, amen.